just moved in my new house today. Moving was rough, but I got squared away. My chain started ringing and bells ringing loud. I knew I moved in a haunted house. Still I made up my mind to stay. And nothing was gonna drive me away. When I saw something that gave me the creeps. Too big.
Was he like a smaller guy, bald?
I think so. Was he the guy that you danced in front of?
Yeah, I wouldn't doubt it. That's my luck.
Okay, guys, welcome back to the Grimerica Show. We're going to be talking to Matt Swayne a little bit later about all sorts of rock and roll and ghosts and all that sorts of fun stuff. But first, as always, I forget what I was going to say. But it was, I think it was Standing Graham.
Standing Graham? Yeah. Oh, that's right. I am standing.
There you go. Took you a minute.
I thought it was a Stampede reference.
That would be Stampin' Graham.
Stampin' Graham.
Which could also mean when you poop a little in your pants, in your underwear, you stamp them.
Really? That's what Northern Ontario's used to call them? Used to call it?
I don't know. I didn't do it often, but yeah, stamp in your pants. You never heard of that?
I've heard touching cloth.
Touching cloth?
Yeah.
Well, I guess the stamp would be the sitting result.
On it. Like touching cloth. Touching cloth. So no, we're standing up in the new studio. Well, I am anyways. Darren's on a stool.
I prefer to sit.
Speaking of stools. yeah, it's hopefully it sounds a little better. I don't know.
When you stand, you feel like you get more out of your voice?
No, I mean in this new studio.
Oh yeah, it's been
and
a
it's
few
just
episodes.
Easier for me to move around and stuff. I felt like I was stuck on the carpet before. We had a carpeted room before. It was kind of awkward.
It was. It seems so much bigger now that I put the laminate in there. It seems like it's a hall. It seems like we could have a couple podcasts in there. You were already thinking that's where we should do the round of one. You forget that it's like 6 inches bigger than this room.
Yeah, that's true. Eh? So Matt Swayne, that was a great chat. I thought that was one of my favorites. We chatted about
it was
all
fun.
Kinds of cool stuff.
He's a listener too, right?
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah, it's always fun to have someone on the show and find out that they listen to the show.
I've got a little email.
And they already know about our bullshit.
I've got an email to talk about in the outro.
In the outro?
Yeah. Why the outro? Because I don't want people to hear it now before the chat.
Oh, it's incriminating?
No, not at all. It's just funny.
Oh.
Yeah.
So how you been?
Good, man. I'm excited.
You're excited?
I'm excited because I feel like there's lots of good stuff coming to town.
Coming to Calgary?
Yeah.
The Stampede?
No.
I'm leaving town.
No, not the Stampede event and stuff.
Do tell.
Well, we have Randall Carlson and Ed Nightingale and a team of people.
Buddy Bill.
Our tribe of people and our buddy Bill Loeb. They're coming to do some research in the Rockies, I guess. And there's a small chance we might be able to have an event for them in Calgary. But I don't want to say too much because I don't think there's enough time to organize it, but we're going to give it a shot.
It's more likely we'll do a big group podcast with them, and who knows, maybe if we end up out for drinks or something like that one night, we could tweet something out so some of our Calgary listeners like Brent and Mark and even Davin down in Lethbridge ain't too far off. You know, there's a couple people that might make the trip to meet Randall,
like a little
even
meet if it was
just
kind of thing,
yeah, even if it was just for a beer or something one afternoon.
Yeah, maybe
if they're not too busy.
But I am checking with some venues to see if we can do a presentation.
We could have it in the Igloo.
So there's a few things I want to talk about as far as events coming up. And if people are interested, we do have some Calgary listeners. I know it gets a little local for the global listeners, but some of these events are traveling around as well. So, but if you have interest in this stuff, let me know, because that'll sort of help me gauge how much effort to put into some of it. You want me to talk about the next one?
Are you going to go into it then?
Or? Yeah.
Okay. Or so, that's the extent of the effort for this week.
So the Modern Knowledge guys who put on the Disclosure Canada, they've got another event coming up, and it's across Canada. I guess it's in Calgary, Vancouver, and Eastern Canada as well. But I'm going to talk about the Calgary one here. They have Nassim Harriman, Marty Leeds, and Patty Greer coming to present.
I believe so, we've tried to get Nassim on the show, haven't we?
Yeah, he's pretty hard to get a hold of. So he's going to be presenting here, and he's going to be presenting some of his latest results published in his paper, Quantum Gravity and the Holographic Mass.
Holograph?
Where his precise prediction of the charge radius of the proton was made, confirmed experimentally since then. He'll expand on this result and discuss the implications of such a discovery to cosmogenesis and its consequences to our daily life, from social structures to energy production and health. So his presentation is called The Connected Universe, A Fundamental Transformation of Human Awareness. And then Marty Leeds, who we also want to have on the show, he's going to be deconstructing the mathematical foundation of the English alphabet. So he takes us through a step-by-step deconstruction of the mathematical foundation of the English alphabet, decoding the cipher used to create the alphabet by exploring the ancient science known as gematria. Using mystical, religious, and secret society symbols, methodologies, and concepts, as well as the transcendental and infinite number of pi, Marty will unravel the occult and esoteric application of the English alphabet in myriad ways. And then Patty Greer.
A myriad of ways?
No, it just says myriad. That's myriad is like that. You can say it like that. It doesn't have to be a myriad.
Are you sure?
I'm pretty sure, yeah.
I'm checking. So keep
go
going.
Go ahead. It's probably just plural okay, like keep that. Going. And then Patty Greer, Crop Circle's Keys of Wisdom. She's going to be, she says, finally, we have some answers. Science and metaphysics explain this phenomena as a co-creation or co-communication between Earth, sky beings, and our consciousness. Yeah, this is interesting. Intentional high frequencies are spun and set to precision, delivering messages of great importance for centuries. This crash course in Crop Circles offers a bird's eye view and a backstage pass to this stunning phenomena. So that's just the Calgary event. And then there's different presenters going across Canada, Montreal, Toronto, Calgary, Vancouver, and Victoria. For example, in Vancouver, it's Nassim, Dr. Carmen Bulter, Marty Leeds, and Michael Cremo. So that would be a good one as well.
Cremo's coming to town?
No, he's going to Vancouver. Oh. Are you paying attention?
I'm running the show.
You're trying to.
No, I gave block up on that. You right.
gave up on that? Okay. So you ready for this one, Darren? I think this is the one you'll be most excited about.
Coming to town?
Yeah.
Am I in town?
Yeah. I got an email from Deborah Warren. She's been taking Stephen Greer's ET contact sessions. I guess what would you call it? Training sessions, really, probably.
Richards?
Yeah. And she says she's going to be driving around in BC and Alberta. And if you can host an ET contact event, basically like offer up your living room for a presentation and a nearby park for the evening field event, to let her know. So I have to contact people if I'm interested. I'm definitely interested. I think around the end of August, around August 30th, she's going to be in Calgary. So I'm going to try and do something around then, so the end of summer. But people, please let me know if you're interested. And so that sounds to me like we do like a little presentation and then we'd go out and actually do the field work and try and like contact ET in the field, right? Like using the protocols of CSETI and stuff like that. So how about that one, Darren?
You're going to go?
Yeah, fuck yeah.
I'm going to let you do this one solo.
I've got my app. I was using my app when I was out in the woods on my own there.
What day of the week?
No, it's probably the end of August, yeah. So there's also another one, but I'm not going to talk about it unless I know they're coming to town and I'm waiting to hear. So, yeah.
Well, when are you going to know? This is our last intro recording night for like a while.
Yeah, that's true, eh? Slipped my mind. Kevin Barrett.
Oh, that's right.
Kevin Barrett, Truth Jihad. I think he's trying to come to Calgary, Lethbridge, and Jasper, maybe, in August, but it's not finalized. So, but anyways, truthjihad.com. Maybe I'll just send a link in the show notes and people can keep an eye on it.
There you go.
And if they find, I'll lose track of all this shit. So if anybody finds out anything, email me, graham@grimerica.com. That's totally fine.
That's if Barrett makes it, if Barrett makes it over the border.
I think last time he got turned around. Yeah.
That'll happen. One of these days, you're going to get turned around.
So what do you do for your day job?
Are you Graham from Grimerica?
Now, what did that guy ask me again? Do you remember that? He says,
I can't remember. Oh, you were reading into something that wasn't there, I think.
Yeah, like always.
Story of your life, eh?
Oh, you know what else is happening? Kraftwerk is coming to Calgary. Kraftwerk in 3D.
Kraftwerk?
Yeah.
I don't get it. What is that, like it's crafts?
It's a band, an electronic band from Germany. Like pretty much like the original electronic stuff, like back when Jean-Michel Jarre was popular with his Oxygen album and all that, and there was Kraftwerk.
Never heard of it.
The Robots. You've never heard of the Robots?
No.
We are the Robots.
This is why I don't let you have clips. You shouldn't have clips. The funny thing is it's not recording.
Really?
Yeah.
Are you recording anything?
I'm recording everything.
But not that clip of the robot. So I just played Kraftwerk the Robots for people.
Well, we're less likely to get sued now.
Yeah, that's true.
Actually, in my experience, they don't sue you. They just put ads in your YouTube videos.
Is that how they get away with it?
Yeah, that's what I figured out. If I wanted to take the ads off of those videos, then I'd have to go through and take a certain song out.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you do it?
No,
fuck it. We should. We don't have any ads here in Grimerica.
Whatever. We use their music and like a bunch of people listen to that album. But some of them are popular episodes, so whatever.
Okay.
They do their little ad. It's not us. Just so you know, it's not our fucking ad.
Yeah.
I put it in the comments that it's not our ad.
We purposefully...
But then I got to go re-edit it or, you know, it's just the whole production.
Yeah. No, so we just try not to put that type of music in here, right? So speaking of that,
I can't remember what it was. It's even some of those remixes or knows, whatever.
It could have been the psilocybus one because I played some...
The psilocybus one, it never even let me put on YouTube because there was too much copyrighted music.
So, speaking of ads and stuff, though, we purposefully don't have any ads. We don't have any sponsorship. We don't have any portals, no breaks. So, we basically try it for the value model, right? If people think that this provides value, we do have expenses here and we like help paying for them. But there's other ways you can contribute as well by putting like reviews on iTunes, sending us emails and your stories. What else, Darren? Sign up for a newsletter.
Signing your friends up for the newsletter.
Send in jingles.
Send in jingles.
Artwork. Yeah. We've had some really good help with people doing the newsletter for us, people doing the website, like Darnell Digital. So it's really helpful. We put a lot of time in and we don't want to have people fucking listening to advertisements and stuff.
No. So the easiest way, I guess, is grimerica.ca/support for monetary. grimerica.ca/news for the newsletter. If you already signed up for the newsletter, just sign up some other people. Say you want to tell some people about the Grimerica show, but you don't really like to talk about it. Just fucking sign them up for the newsletter. Pow. They won't know you did it. It'll just happen. There you have it. Or maybe you know some code that'll just start sending it out to random email addresses. Spamming Graham across the internet. You can do that too and we won't complain.
So speaking of reviews, actually one of our listeners was having troubles doing a review on iTunes. No, because I had this experience too. So just, I don't know what it is, but sometimes it's hard. Like it might take iTunes a while to recognize the review and put it out there. And sometimes it just doesn't work, right? You've never had this problem?
I've never had a problem. No.
But
make sure you're signed in, because if you're not signed in with your Apple ID, then you can't leave a review. I don't know if it notifies you or not or what it does, but you have to be signed in.
There is some trippy things happening with it, though. So just try again and appreciate the effort. Can I read this one? We usually don't read them, but some of them.
You read one every show.
What? No, I don't.
The last few shows.
Some of them describe it pretty good, so that's why I like to read it.
Okay.
That's pretty humbling, though. This is from Bizarro Titan. He says, accepting the call to review. I've been listening to podcasts for going on 5 years, and I'm ecstatic to say that Grimerica is among the shows that those who follow esoteric topics should listen to. There are numerous reasons why the show is so great, but as I'm typing this on my phone and subsequently have fat thumbs, I'll just list a few.
Subsequently. I let you off with Marriott.
Firstly, Darren and Graham
would subsequently be like a subsequence.
Oh, fuck. Are you really going to do this to me now in the middle of this review?
I'm asking a question, a serious question.
It's probably from subsequent, right?
Subsequential.
Yeah, so that's how I pronounce it.
Wrong. Maybe actually it might be right for the UK. Ask your, we need Morgan and not Morgan to comment on that. Some reflective air.
Yeah. Hey, guys. Firstly, Darren and Graham are genuinely funny. Over the years, I've found myself rolling my eyes at other podcasts as the hosts awkwardly try to be funny. Grimerica gets the formula right, meaning that they have a perfect mix of hilarity and serious discussion. Secondly, the guest selection is varied. As you listen to paranormal / esoteric topics, you begin seeing the same guests and hearing essentially the same interview. Darren and Graham do a great job of varying the guest list to include experts in many fields. Sure, Grimerica has some guests that other podcasts get too, but they also have many others that I've only heard on Grimerica. Finally, the interviews they conduct with the guests always contain thoughtful questions, as well as allowing the guests plenty of time to fully cover their topic. The only negative thing I have to mention is the show almost injured me at the gym once upon a workout. Darren called Graham an idiot for mispronouncing a name, and I laughed right at it as I was doing the bench press. Needless to say, I learned not to listen to the podcast while bench pressing. Bottom line, great host, great guest, great show. I highly recommend giving Grimerica a try. So,
you think we get sued for that? Eh?
No.
He breaks his ribs. I don't think I ever called you an idiot, dude.
Yeah. You've probably called me an idiot before.
You think so?
Yeah. Do you know what's weird about this is he says esoteric a couple of times when I was at that Freemason open house. I said esoteric. And to one of the Freemason guys who was kind of giving me the rundown. And he responded and he said that. And he said it in such a different way, the pronunciation, I didn't even know what word he was talking about.
How'd he say it?
I can't even remember.
Did he say it like subsequently?
Yeah, like I can't even think of it. Like I can't even begin to pronounce it a different way.
Esoteric.
He said
esoteric?
He said the esoteric pot. Caught topics and it took me like 10 seconds to figure out.
Sometimes it's just people just grew up saying it wrong and nobody wanted to say anything.
You think that's what it is?
Yeah. I know people who still say sayings wrong and I'm just like, no, I just let them get away with it.
There's some that people like, always get wrong. Like down the tunnel.
Like
there's
ball one. And so, you know how you say like the ball's in your court?
Yeah.
I know a guy, he always says it's in your ball and court. And I just let it slide all the time.
What about down the pipe, down the pike? People say, what is it when they say down the pike or whatever?
I've never heard of that. Down the pike.
Yeah, not down the pike. But anyways, and it's pipe or pipe, pike. They always get it wrong.
I would say down the pipe. Down
the pike. I can't remember the gist of it.
The gist?
Somebody told me that the other day.
Oh, yeah. That's a bad one. That's like Ricky from Trailer Park Boys.
It was my girlfriend.
What goes around, what comes around is all around. Yeah, well, thanks for the review. Those are always pretty humbling. I mean, we're only 2 years into this. I would say the show is like constantly evolving, constantly in a state of evolution. You know what? It'd be interesting to go back and listen to the first, like go back, listen to episode 1. 20,
I can
40,
do
40, 60.
Yeah, something like that.
And like jump it ahead and see how it's growing. So if we ever start doing something that you don't fucking like, just email us.
Yeah, tell totally. Us to quit it. We're not stuck on anything, right?
No, we really anything goes.
We didn't plan on doing big intros before.
We didn't plan on doing these this long.
Interview or anything like that. But it's just we're incorporating listener feedback and listener stories and stuff like that. We do like to try and make people a part of the whole thing, right?
We need more listener stories. Yeah. I'd like the intro to be less your thoughts and more their thoughts.
Thanks, buddy.
And so when do I myself get to too. Express my myself thoughts? Too. Well, we can throw that in before we get to it. But it seems like we've been struggling lately.
With what?
Stories.
Yeah.
A lot of feedback and stuff, which is great and it's humbling, but we can't just sit here and read that stuff on the air all day.
Yeah.
We do read it all and we appreciate it, but it's the stories are the ones that we can really.
Yeah.
Turn into content.
Yeah, and people have strange experiences all the time. And this is like what's changing our paradigm right now is people having experiences and talking about them. And that's one of the reasons why I like doing the podcast, because we should feel comfortable that we can talk about strange experiences without being ridiculed or judged. So speaking of that, I have a UFO quote, if you want to play your jingle.
I'm not ready.
It's the Aussie Derrier. Do you right? Profound UFO quote of the week. Derrier, do you right? I am any
Derrier. All right, this is the profound UFO quote of the week. There were 8 of us, including me and the farm owner. We had 3 military men, including my son, then a lieutenant and now a major, and a friend of his, a major in the Air Force, a professor of physics, a professor of law, and others in different professions. There were 8 of us, all friends, and we saw the object clearly in front of us, radiating an intense bluish-whitish light. Then quickly the object disappeared and immediately appeared to the right at a higher point in the mountains. That's from General Alfredo Mosier Uca, former deputy director of the Military Academy of Brazil.
Ooh, he's got some brass.
Yeah.
All right, let's go with another one.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah.
Fucker.
X-Files coming back.
This is a U.S. Oh, no, is it?
I'm pretty sure they're coming back with like a 6-episode something or other.
Really? That'll be awesome. Oh. As we approached this glow, it turned into a monstrous circle of white lights on the water. Then we saw a yellow halo, small, much smaller than whatever it was it launched from, about 15 miles away. It seems like a long way away. As the UFO approached my plane and flew alongside it, we could see the domed craft, which had a corona discharge. Oh, that's Commander Graham Bethune, U.S. Navy sighting from military, flying from Iceland and Newfoundland, February 10th, 1951.
Sunday, January 24th, 2016, will be the 2-night premiere of The Return of X-Files, 6 episodes.
Sorry, what night?
January 24th, 2016.
Wow, right on.
Maybe we could come out with an after-show podcast. Get hugely popular with the mainstream, and then we'll just talk about Grimerica all the time.
I don't understand what you mean.
Oh, you know, all those shows seem to do real well, like that, The Talking Dead, or, you know, we're like right after the show's over, you talk about it on your, people call in and listen. People are super addicted to TV shows.
You mean The Walking Dead?
Yeah, but The Talking Dead is a podcast.
Is it really? And they talk about The Walking Dead?
Yeah, about really? The episode you just watched.
No. Yeah. Really?
Yeah.
People do that?
That's a thing, man. And it's like, I think pretty sure like every show has one.
Really?
Yeah.
So like Game of Thrones was have a... Actually, you know what? I used to listen to a podcast for a fantasy series of novels. Robert Jordan, they used to talk about it. So I guess it's the same thing, kind of.
That's crazy anyway. It's Duchovny and what's her name again, too? Jillian.
Duchovny?
David Duchovny. What would you say?
No, I said it properly. You didn't.
Duchovny?
Yeah.
What'd you say?
Duchovny.
No, it's Duchovny. Anyway.
Ever see Californication? We should do a rundown of that one.
I haven't seen a lot of it.
That was great.
I think I've only seen an episode or two. I should put that on my list.
That was really good, yeah. You could binge watch it while your wife's still out of town, because she may not like it.
I don't have fucking time anymore. I ran out of time so fast. Like, the whole weekend went dealing with that fucking tree and then the shed that the tree subsequently fell through. So that had to be... I fit almost the entire shed in my recycling bin, though. Those little aluminum panels fold up real. So that took up the whole weekend, and then podcast all night yesterday, podcast all night tonight. I still got to finish the trim on the old studio.
Got to edit these.
Got to edit two episodes and have them ready to go for while I'm gone.
Yeah.
Friday night's a write-off.
Work all day. Busy man. At least the wife knows you're not getting into trouble.
Don't have time to get into trouble. But then I go away and I'll have no fucking podcast to worry about and no work to worry about. I don't really have much reception out there. So it's just...
Disengage.
Nice. And fishing. And I'm actually thinking I'm just going to shut my phone off because it doesn't work in Manitoba anyway. And I'm there for 5 days. So the only time I could use it was when I'm on my sister's Wi-Fi. And then I can use it... In Red Lake, I think it works, but that's the last half of the trip when we're on the lake. So I'm thinking I might just, I'll turn it on once a day for an hour or something.
Nice.
See what happens.
Right on. Well, have a good trip, buddy.
Yeah, should be good. This episode will come up before that. Then we have our pre-recorded interview with our intro with RPJ. It'll come out on next week's episode, and you guys won't even know that we were gone.
Yeah.
And we should get back to some sort of a regular schedule after this. Okay, guys, enjoy the chat with Matt Swayne. You got anything else?
That's it.
Enjoy the chat with Matt, and pick you up in the outro.
Ciao.
Okay, guys, in Grimerica tonight, we're going to be finally chatting a little bit of haunting and ghosts and a little rock and roll, too, so that should be fun. You looking forward to this one?
I am. Really looking forward to it. Yeah, especially after browsing through his book here, is bringing up old memories of my favorite bands from the 80s and stuff, so I can't wait to talk to Matt Swayne about this. He's been writing for... We're going to talk to him about this as well, but Omni Reboot, I think. He's got an antimatter column which looks at fringe science and the paranormal. He's one of these guys. He balances skepticism with an open mind, and he uses his experience in journalism and interest in both ghost lore and the paranormal to collect and tell stories about the supernatural. So his latest book is Haunted Rock and Roll, and he's also got one out called America's Haunted Universities. I'm going to read a little the last paragraph of the introduction of Haunted Rock and Roll. I felt like it fit. So it's time to plug in, tune up, raise the curtain, and take our first step on the long, winding, and haunted road of rock and roll's paranormal legacy as we pay visit to rock stars who, like the music itself, never die. So without any more of this rambling, Matt, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. I'm a big fan of the show, and it's great to be on.
Yeah, that's pretty trippy for us, but how's everything going?
Really good so far. I finished up this Haunted Rock and Roll one. I'm actually working on another one. It's going to be on country music. So
nice.
We might not want to have you back on. we might pass on the next book.
Yeah, well, I can understand that. especially after I heard Keith Urban has a new song out. I think it's John Cougar, John Deere, and John 316. I don't know whether I can embrace the new country music.
No, but the old shit is still the shit.
Oh yeah, the Johnny Cash. That's kind of what I really focused on that book.
You know, I used to always like the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band too.
Right.
Fishing in the Dark and shit.
Yeah.
You don't like that? Graham's just grimacing over here.
Well, it's just grimacing the one. It's probably like the one genre I have a hardest time with. I don't know why. Some of it I don't mind actually, but some of it's kind of weird. It gives me strange memories. I kind of like the more like the rock and roll stuff, like the Led Zeppelin. I kind of, not that I just like that. I like all kinds of rock music as well. But back, I went through quite a Zeppelin phase, Pink Floyd and Zeppelin in my teens anyways.
Yeah, I think we all had a Led Zepp phase.
Yeah. And you wrote about those guys a little bit, eh?
Yeah, I did. And actually, to build on something you said, you know, what really happened with this book was that I was in the middle of working on the Haunted University book, and the acquisition editor said, you know, do you have anything else? And, you know, I read some Gary Patterson's book on A Walk on the Dark Side, and he mainly he talks a lot about sort of the conspiracy and the occult of rock and roll, not so much the paranormal, but he does have a few stories in there. So when my acquisition editor asked me that, I said, well, you know, I'm going to write a book about haunted rock and roll, and there's all these stories. And honestly, I really had no idea how many there were.
Oh, that's pretty funny.
When I started to investigate, I found more and more. And Led Zepp certainly stands out as probably one of the most paranormally active bands in rock and roll.
That's because he's half dead.
Yeah, that's true.
Or looks half dead. He looks like he could have died before.
Led Robert Plant?
Oh, sorry. No, I'm thinking Rolling Stones. Yeah.
I don't know. Plant looks pretty bad too.
It's funny because they do have that interest. Like they sing about, you know, Middle Earth and all that too, which was always kind of attractive to me, right? The songs about Mordor and the Battle of Evermore and all that is pretty cool. So I can see they're having the haunted interest as well.
Right. And you know, the thing about rock and roll that made it so interesting for me to write about and research, you know, and honestly, when I start the book, I just approach it more as a journalist. I want to find the best stories, the most compelling stories, not necessarily the creepiest ones, but, you know, the book, the stories range from what I consider ghost lore, which is just kind of folklore based on ghosts, where the narrative's being driven by ghosts, to actual paranormal accounts. But what I find is that as I started to research this and get into it more, there's sort of like a hidden layer of this supernatural stories to rock and roll. And I think it gets to something you pointed out about this kind of Celtic mythology in Led Zeppelin's. What you have is you have rock and roll as this combination of, you know, African-American musical styles, whether it's the blues, rhythm and blues, black gospel, those types of musics combined with, you know, white European music, bluegrass, country, all of those. And as I got into it, I find that rock and roll is really a blend of all those kind of occult lore, supernatural and paranormal. So everything runs the gamut. You have stories, I think, that are pretty much based on African-American mythology and ghost lore, such as like Robert Johnson and the Crossroads Curse, to people like Led Zeppelin, which their music and their lyrics are really based on Celtic and pre-Christian mythology. So, you know, I don't want to get too heavy in the books and talk a lot about it, but it's one of those things when you write a book, you learn a lot more than, you know, your probably reader ever picks up.
Yeah, that's interesting. That's something I never thought about, the origins of rock. And you mentioned the two places, you know, from the States that have supernatural underpinnings, and you know, for some reason that's where kind of rock and roll had its genesis.
Where's that?
Well, I think there's one near in Appalachia, is it?
Appalachia? Like where Micah Hanks lives?
So, you mean Memphis or Nashville?
Nashville's Tennessee, right?
Yeah.
Or Memphis. I don't know where the fuck Memphis is.
Memphis is Tennessee, too. Oh. But, you know, I would say that the real birth of rock and roll happens in the Mississippi Delta. With Robert Johnson, and he starts more a lot of the rock myths that you hear about, a lot of the rock lore that you hear about is based on Robert Johnson. For instance, he was probably the founder of the 27 Club, which is this propensity for rock stars to kick the bucket when they hit around 27. And it started with him, and it ends, well, it's still going on with Amy Winehouse and Kurt Cobain. But, you know, also the Crossroads idea itself of selling your soul to the devil, he kind of starts that, even though it was, it was a common kind of folklore tradition before that. But then there's this other notion that playing the song Crossroads Blues, which is Robert Johnson's one of his signature songs, that too is supposedly cursed. I think it was the Allman Brothers used to play that quite a bit. Lynyrd Skynyrd played that somewhat. You know, there's even stories about Kurt Cobain wanting to cover that. So Robert Johnson kind of starts it all, and he is called the grandfather of rock and roll for a reason. I mean, he starts the whole rock mythos of that, you know, live hard, party hard, and die young type of thing.
Do you think that has something to do with all this? Because when you read, you glance through all the chapters of your book and all, there's a lot of prominent stars on there that have had experiences. Like, if you were to totally speculate, just like totally open-mindedly, I mean, is there some sort of connection, you think? Some sort of occult or hidden connection between yeah, like the supernatural and manifesting this type of music?
So that's a great question. It's something I've thought about a lot. And the kind of conclusion I came to is, if you can think of a religious spiritual tradition that doesn't have music involved, I can't think of one. So I think music is a very spiritual act. I think it combines the rational, you know, that kind of mathematical formulas that create harmonies and melodies.
Timing.
With, you know, this kind of spiritual aspect of it, the inspiration. So I think that all music is inherently spiritual. What I find different, you know, investigating the country from the rock and roll is that rock and roll really has this dark side. And I think the dark side comes from what I call the outsider spirituality of rock and roll. And if you think about rock and roll, the evolution of rock and roll, it's not a linear type of evolution. It kind of goes, it fits and starts. So you have Robert Johnson comes out, then a few years later you have, well, decades later, you have Elvis, who comes out and he is totally extreme. The mainstream doesn't embrace him. And then suddenly he comes back and the mainstream loves him. And then he turns him into basically a matinee idol. He gets kind of lame. Then there's years of nothing more than these teen idols. And then you have the Beatles come along with their long hair and people make fun of them. Mm-hmm. So it's this kind of evolution that I see that, I guess my point is they're used to being outsiders. So when they come into it, you know, you have the Beatles when they came in with the Maharishi and embracing Eastern spirituality. Led Zeppelin had Aleister Crowley. So I think that's the difference with rock and roll, is they're not afraid of this dark side.
Yeah, the rebel side, almost like kind of resisting the mainstream to begin with.
Absolutely.
Huh. That's interesting. Did you ever come across Pink Floyd at all? That was another one of my favorites back then. And they had always such a trippy sound.
Right. I haven't come across any of that. That's actually, you know, I'm starting to collect material for a sequel, I think. And so I'm trying to visit any of the places that I, or any of the groups or people that I didn't, you know, kind of focus on, like Pink Floyd. And Pink Floyd would have been an obvious one, but I didn't find anything about them. And I'm trying to think, the other one that I didn't find anything was Jimi Hendrix, which was heartbreaking.
Oh, yeah.
I did find just recently that the hotel room where he died in London, or yeah, I think he died there. It's supposedly haunted. So I'll have to find out more about that.
Right. So you categorized your book in a different ways. So you had some personal, not personal, but I guess stories about the stars themselves. And then you got into, there's some that, what is it here? You got the rock star ghosts, and then you got haunted studios and concert venues, which is a whole other interesting topic. Premonition mm-hmm. signs, omens of rock and roll, and then rock and roll's most famous curses. So how did did you realize when you're getting all this material, you're like, hey, there's enough here for like a few different segments?
Well, it started out, my idea was just to write about rock stars who turned into ghosts.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So, but when I started investigating, some of the stories were so good that I thought, well, I'm going to try to expand on it, and then maybe I'll have material for another book. So that, when I was doing the studios, those stories were so fascinating to me, that I felt like I had to include them. And I think the curses and the conspiracy type stories in rock and roll that Gary Patterson writes about and writes so effectively about, I felt like I had to include that, because if someone's going to read the book, they're probably going to go, well, you know, what's the deal with the 27 Club that you mentioned with Robert Johnson? And, you know, what's the deal with the Buddy Holly curse that you mentioned? So I included those. That's kind of the genesis of that.
Yeah, no, that's interesting. I like that. Can you talk about, well, let's stay on this topic for a little bit while we're there. Can you talk about some of your favorite ones that you found?
The favorite ones. So there are ones that I find that were pretty creepy, and spooked me out a little bit. So Led Zeppelin had the most of those. And, the one that stands out to me is Bulliskin House, which is originally owned. Well, I can't say originally owned, but it was formerly owned by Aleister Crowley. And, you know, Jimmy Page was a big Aleister Crowley fan and actually bought the house because, you know, most people, when they find out the Antichrist lived in your house, you try to not buy that house. So. You know, Page was a realtor's dream, and he bought it because of Crowley. And there were several stories in the book that I found. There's one story in particular of a friend. You know, it's really easy when you're researching these stories, knowing about rock and roll and rock stars and their propensity for, you know, drinking and drugs, to just kind of label everything, well, they were all high. But Jimmy Page talks about his friend who was sober and straight, and he stayed overnight, and he heard this the sound of rolling coming down the hall. Something was bouncing around out there. And so the next morning he talks to the caretaker and said, hey, can you leave the cats out? They were leaving, I was awake all night listening to this, you know, rolling around in the hall. And that's when the caretaker told him that there was one story about Bulliskin House where a person was beheaded in that hall. And some people hear the sound of this head rolling down the hall. The interesting thing for me about this was, and I got this from a Rolling Stone interview, the interviewer says to Page, did you ever hear this, you know, head rolling down the hall? And Page says, no, I never heard it. And the interviewer then said, so you don't believe your house is haunted? And he said, I didn't say that. I said that I never heard this, you know, particular phenomena. So it makes you think that he did witness something to it. There's another story of a painting levitating off the wall. A bunch of people saw that. So again, when I look at these stories, I have this idea of some of these stories are ghost lore. They're just organic stories that arise from fans who love these people so much they don't want to get, you know, have them leave. And then there are stories that seem to be more like paranormal accounts of people encountering something they can't explain. For instance, you know, these people who see a painting levitate off the wall, or these kind of sounds. So Led Zeppelin would definitely win for creepiest stories in the book. But, you know, the one thing that I found out about writing this book is discovering some people that I didn't know about. For instance, Eddie Hinton, there's a little chapter in about his ghost story. He was a musician in Muscle Shoals, which is this area in the South, known for producing great musicians and great rock and roll musicians and great rhythm and blues players. There's a good documentary about Muscle Shoals too, if you ever have a chance to see it. I think it's just called Muscle Shoals. But anyways, Eddie Hinton is pretty much, to me, was unknown. And I found the ghost story first, and then I started listening to his music, and he's a great player, and he wrote some great tunes. But he was one of these guys that was, I would say, he was a session player, so he played on a lot of other people's albums. But a lot of people think he was destined for greatness. He was a good guitar player, he was a good singer, and he was a good songwriter. Unfortunately, had a problem with depression and drug and alcohol abuse, and he died pretty young. A band was in one of these studios in Muscle Shoals, and they said, you know, after they were finished recording, they had a few minutes. They were pretty much alone in the studio, and they saw this guy walking down the hall with a blue suit on, and you know, they mentioned it looked a lot like a 70s suit, like a guy from the 70s. And then they later found out that Eddie Hinton, who apparently haunted this studio, was buried in a blue suit. So I started to find stories like that. I found a story about Joe Meek, who was this crazy, amazing record producer that probably had a slight bit of to do with the Beatles making it in America. He was the one who produced the Tornadoes, Telstar. He was just absolutely fascinating. He apparently freaked out Buddy Holly one year when Buddy Holly was he was touring the UK, and Joe Meek had this. He was always interested in the occult, and he would go to these tarot card readings. And he got a message that Buddy Holly was going to die February 3rd. So he rushed to Buddy Holly's hotel and told Buddy Holly that he had this urgent message that he was going to die on February 3rd. February 3rd came and went. Buddy Holly was fine. He probably thought, you know, Joe Meeks was a nut. But actually, Buddy Holly died the following year, February 3rd, 1959. So I guess when you are working with your tarot card reader, please ask for specifics.
Yeah, what year?
Yeah. So wow, those were some of the ones I found.
Yeah.
That I thought were interesting that I probably never would have discovered had I not written the book. Hmm.
So what's your take on ghosts then? If you've done this, all this investigation, like, you know how we hear people, there's all kinds of different theories nowadays about, you know, I don't know, dimensional bleed or whatever. You know, all kinds of
residue
and, you know, emotional
residue.
Yeah.
That would be, because it always seems to be like there has to be a lot of emotion involved.
Yeah. But you must have seen these stories that make it really seem like it is somebody that's passed over and it's their spirit.
Yeah. You know, there are a lot of the stories. It's hard to kind of source who's doing the haunting. For instance, Janis Joplin, there are a lot of stories about her haunting the hotel room where she died. And actually, when you look at it, it's how, you know, I guess I always have that question.
As a fan.
You know, how do you know that it was her and not, you know, Joe Smith, who just happened to die, you know, in the same room a few years earlier. Mm-hmm. So, you know, to be honest with you, I kind of approach this with an open mind, and I can write these things. And in the beginning of the story, I can pretty much feel that this is a real ghost story. In the middle, I might decide that it's, you know, misidentified natural phenomena. And then sometimes at the end, I'm somewhere in the middle. And I think that comes because I used to cover local politics as a journalist. And if anything makes you a cynic, it's local politics, probably all politics.
Local, the least probably.
Yeah. But I guess, over the years writing this stuff, I have my own feeling that, it's probably, you know, if this phenomenon is real, I don't know whether it's kind of this traditional idea of a person has a soul and this soul somehow gets trapped, you know, in a bar or in a studio. I think it is really a psychic thing in that, and psychic in the real term of it, that it's a psyche, it's your psyche. And it almost feels like it's a connection with the living person, with you know, something out there. And I, you know, it's hard for me to explain, but you know, I almost think it has to be something with another dimension. What I guess my conclusion is, it's every time I try to explain it, I use this kind of quasi materialistic Newtonian way of explaining it. And I have a feeling it's not going to be anything like that. The one thing that I've learned writing these things is I do believe in the weird. I do believe in the fringe. And I don't know whether we would be able to explain it.
Yeah, that makes sense. I understand what you mean. But you did say something there, like if it's a real phenomenon, but do you believe that it's a real phenomenon that's worth investigating? Like something is going on, isn't it? Whether that's like a dead relative's, you know, coming back or lingering around or whatever is one thing, but there is a phenomenon to be investigated, isn't there?
Yeah. I mean, I've come to the conclusion, you know, after writing this, I lean more towards the believer now than the total cynic. So I think there's something there to look into. I think there's something there. Ultimately, I think this is a question for yourself. I think everyone wants proof, but I don't think we're going to find proof. I think the proof comes from within.
Yeah.
And I know that kind of sounds new agey and woo woo, but
not to me, it doesn't.
Okay. But, you know, I think that's the real key, because, you know, I work as a science and research writer, which adds a lot of complications to my life. but, you know, when you talk to some people who are total cynics about it, and I try to differentiate myself between a skeptic and a cynic. If you talk about this, they will ultimately have, you know, just like you talk to someone about a UFO and they're immediately going to say it was swamp gas or it was, you know, temperature of inversion, even though, you know, those conditions can exist in some cases, they'll still claim it's that. And likewise with ghosts, you know, if I talk to someone about, you know, I've had some experiences which I can explain naturally, but happen with such frequency that it almost makes me feel like a natural explanation is weirder than, you know, a supernatural paranormal thing. But if you talk to these folks, they'll immediately say, oh, well, it was a mass hallucination or it's a hallucination. I mean, how can you fight back with that? So ultimately, I think it's one of the, I actually like the uncertainty. I don't want it to be proven one way or the other. I kind of like it that way. Other people, you know, aren't that way.
Yeah.
What's mass hallucination anyway? Like, really?
Well, that seems really stranger than the strange. I mean,
yeah,
it seems paranormal in itself.
Yeah.
Like, what made it?
Gravity be a mass hallucination?
If there is a mass hallucination, then it alludes immediately to some sort of shared consciousness.
And that's where I think you nailed it right there. Especially when these stories that in Haunted Rock and Roll you have in the country book too, what you have is that connection between the person, the fan, and the, you know, the kind of idol, the object of that emotion. So you have a lot of emotion, and it runs the gamut of that, you know, one kind of sadness that the person left, to trying to bring back the past. All of those emotions, I think, deeply connect all of us in this consciousness. And you know, could it actually bring about changes in the reality? That I could see that.
Yeah. Yeah, I like that. And I agree with you in a way. I don't really need to see the proof either.
Oh, you don't.
My big thing is that it, as long as it's acknowledged as a mystery, that's my sort of problem with this, the super dogmatic skeptical view. And even like on the believer side too, if it's too, you know, believing anything kind of thing, right? I'm happy to stay in the middle, even though Darren probably doesn't think I'm in the middle. But
you're not in the middle. I'm in the middle.
But I don't think I need proof. It's just I wish that there was no less ridicule and just acknowledgement that there is a mystery and that everything wasn't just tried to explain away by, you know, silly things. Some of the skeptical answers are sillier than the paranormal answer itself.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. And then it's what, you know, so when I worked on the university ghost stories, I pretty much approached it just as ghost lore. And I didn't intentionally, but I didn't really kind of seek out paranormal researchers for it. This book, I think on probably four or five of the stories, I actually reached out to people who investigated it because, you know, for one thing, the people that I talked to, the ghost hunters or paranormal researchers or whatever you want to call them, they're really committed to this. They give you a side of it that you don't find necessarily out there. The people I talked to were very trustworthy. And, you know, the other thing about this, writing this is, if I'm out and about, if I'm out at a book signing or something, I am the target of some of the creepiest stories you could ever imagine. Far creepier, weirder than anything I could put in these books. That's really what changed me to more of a believer, less of a skeptic or less of a cynic. Because a lot of the people that approach me with their stories, they're smart people. They don't seem to be prone to hallucinations. You can talk to them about 40 different subjects, and all of those subjects are, you know, within the realm of believability. And then they, boom, they hit you with one of these stories. So they seem, from my era of local politics, everyone has an agenda. I don't know what these people, what their agenda would be,
right,
to talk to me about these and really to open themselves up to humiliation in a lot of cases. Now, since I've written these, I think they trust me. So, you know, but anyways, that's really the, when you have decent, well-meaning people tell you something that is very hard to explain. And a lot of times they look for me, you know, for sympathy. And I tend to just look at them and say, you know, please stop creeping me out because, you know, I got to sleep tonight.
Yeah, it's funny you mentioned that because I was kind of going to go there with my last little rant about you know, the skeptics and the believers, and we talk about this on the show a lot, as you know, is the kind of experience factor, right? I think more and more people are having the experience, and more people, like you're probably finding out firsthand, are willing to talk about their experience. And that's going to bring the middle, hopefully, you know, us into more of a middle ground that's less polarized. I mean, we, you know, most of us are know people that we trust or love that have had experiences if we haven't had them ourselves.
Yeah. I mean, that's totally how I feel. And I had a few strange occurrences when I was living in this apartment that at least opened me up to, and I'm making it sound like I was a complete cynic before this, but it sort of made it more real to me. Mm-hmm. You know, I'll just give you some of the things that happened to me. I came home one day from work, and my bed was completely made, and I can bring my wife into the room and she'll confirm that I don't make the bed. Then a few days later, I was in the kitchen about 30 feet from the television set, and it turned on as I was looking at it, you know, and being the kind of, you know, skeptical mind that I have, I can debunk everything that I told you. I mean, maybe I did make the bed. There was another case where all the doors in the house were closed and the apartment were closed and they're normally left open. You know, maybe I sleepwalk. Now, I never sleptwalk before. I haven't since, but maybe on one occasion I did that. The television turning on in an apartment, infrared signals can go all over the place from other apartments. You know, I can do that, but at least it gave me this notion that there could be. And I think that's what I needed when I was writing these books.
Hmm. Darren, have I talked about my ghost experience at all on the show?
Don't recall.
Let's open it up.
Well, yeah, it's not much of one. I mean, we did have other kind of creepy things happen in the family and neighbors talking about ghosts and this and that growing up. I mean, there was definitely out there, but when we were teenagers, we were staying in, or we were partying in my friend's turret. Like, her dad made a tower in the house, a turret. Mm-hmm. And the house was apparently haunted by this old man. And we were in the turret, and I got to admit, we were partaking in smoking the marijuana at the time. And right. It was dark and we were taking pictures in the dark and stuff like that, but definitely had some weird images come back. One with a guy in a glowing cummerbund and an orb. And you could definitely see some guy standing there. Like, it was definitely the shape of a guy with some glowing bits. Like, he had an old suit on with a cummerbund and tie. And then there was another picture of an orb that just showed up. So yeah, that was definitely pretty creepy for all of us when we got the film developed.
Well, and I think I wanted to add, I think I forgot the most interesting part. I left this apartment. And by the way, I always felt, and for whatever reason, I don't know where I got this idea. I always felt that whatever spirit was in there, if there was a spirit, it was a female presence. And, you know, years later, I'm talking 5-6 years later, I was on Facebook, and one of my Facebook friends mentioned a ghost, and I realized that he was living in my apartment. So I kind of messaged him, and we never talked about this before. I barely even knew he was living in my old apartment. And he began to recount some of the things that happened to him that were absolutely the same things that happened to me. And to the fact that he called it a she. He continually referred to it as a she. So, you know, coincidence, that's a hell of a coincidence.
Yeah, that is. Why was he referring to it as a she, or is that getting a little personal?
No, I for whatever reason, it just felt like a female ghost. It turns out it was a doctor's office, an office for a podiatrist, I think. Oh, a pediatrician. I'm sorry, I always confuse those.
Yeah, me too.
What's the difference?
Well, one's a foot and one's a baby dog. Oh. I think.
Yeah, I think so too. Yeah. Pedal, you know, pedal. Darren.
And peed from?
Don't know. Baby.
Pediatrician.
Peed from baby. So, speaking of coincidences and synchronicities, we talked a lot on the show about that. Did you come across any of those in your research with the musicians?
Yeah, actually, there are, you know, I guess you would call them a synchronicity, but, you know, when you think about the Buddy Holly curse, and that is that people involved with Buddy Holly, his friends, a lot of the people that played on the winter dance party tour, that the ill-fated tour where he died, all of those folks sort of met with bizarre deaths. And it gets real freaky sort of towards the end, where people like Ricky Nelson and Del Shannon, I think both of those guys ended their sets with a Buddy Holly song and then went off to their death. And then Keith Moon, the night before he died, he and his girlfriend and Paul and Linda McCartney went to see the Buddy Holly story. So those types of weird, darker synchronicities pop up. Another place that synchronicities pop up quite a bit, and a synchronicity more as a sign that a person who has passed on is still with them, is the several John Lennon stories. The one story is that he told his son Julian Lennon that if he died, he would reach out to him with a white feather. And years after Lennon was murdered, I think Julian was working at working on a film documentary project in Australia. And one of the folks he was working with, an Aborigine, walked up to him and just said, handed him a white feather, and said, you would need this and you would know what this meant. So there are a lot of those weird synchronicities that pop up with John Lennon. Even as I'm researching into this sequel, I found that May Pang, and May Pang was John Lennon's girlfriend when he and Yoko split for what a lot of people, of rock historians, have referred to as the Lost Weekend. But May Pang continually says that that John still is with her, and she told a story about they were driving into New York one night, and she was telling her friends in the car that, you know, she has this feeling that John's present, and then you know, a song will come on that reminds her of him, or a Beatles song will come on. And some of the friends were skeptical and said, you know, that could happen anytime. You know, the Beatles were kind of popular, so they're on the radio a lot. And just as they said that, a bus cut them off, and they started swearing at the bus, of course, but they realized it was this John Lennon songwriting tour bus. Then there's only one in the nation, and it just happened to almost kill them on the Brooklyn Bridge, or whatever bridge they were on at the time. So, you know, there are a few stories like that. That's not in this book, but might be in the next.
How do you rate that one?
How did Buddy Holly die again?
Buddy Holly died in a plane crash with the Big Bopper and, gosh, now I can't remember his name. They did a movie about him, La Bamba. But in any event, he died in a plane crash in Clear Lake, Iowa. Ricky
Nelson? No.
No. Valance.
It was Valance, Ricky Valance. Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's him.
Huh.
But yeah, he died in a crash. And actually, that crash site is reportedly haunted. A lot of fans go there. Again, to your point about the emotion of it, they go there on the anniversary of his death, February 3rd. And, you know, the stories are you can hear the plane crash, you can hear metal crunching, you can hear screams. People see orbs, they take pictures of orbs, they have strange things that happen. Pieces of the statue fall off at their feet at certain times. All those stories kind of pop up about Buddy Holly's death in that area.
Is there anything, any conspiracies around somebody actually cursing Buddy at all, or something that he did to bring this on? Like, what would be the cause of that? It does sound pretty crazy.
That's absolutely a great question. And believe it or not, I never thought about it, but I should look into that. It almost, you know, the Buddy Holly curse is the people that are connected with him and not Buddy Holly himself. But of any of the rock stars that I studied, you know, he was the one that you really feel didn't deserve to die that young. I mean, some of the guys, let's face it, some of the guys that made the 27 Club, the real miracle is that they made it to 27 at all, right?
How old was Buddy?
Buddy, I'm like not sure.
Younger how old than 27?
I think he was 28 or 29.
Okay, so he's still.
He might have been older. Young, yeah. But I have to check that out. But you know, Buddy Holly, they call February 3rd, 1959, the day the music died for a reason, because Buddy Holly, when you look back in rock and roll history, started to take the music from this novelty stage to real music. And, you know, he was a huge influence on the Beatles. He not only recorded his own songs, he started to produce his own songs. He wrote his own songs. He was working with instrumentation. He was working with all types of technical wizardry that would, you know, only be discovered years later. So when rock and roll lost him, they lost that creative force. And then you see for 3 or 4 years that rock and roll is just, you know, this mindless kind of pop idol thing, you know. And I think I'm overgeneralizing, but for the most part, when they lost him, they really lost kind of the brains of rock music. And it's not until, you know, the Beatles come back to America that you know, we rediscover that. So that's the haunting part about Buddy Holly's death.
Yeah.
And that would be fitting that, you know, if he's the one you didn't see to die, because it seems like, you know, most people move on unless they have some sort of unfinished business, or like, you know, John Lennon got shot. So, you know, he was probably a little pissed about that. Or,
yeah.
Or I wonder if it's more like some people don't know they're dead. You'd think you'd know. If you crashed in a plane, you should know.
Yeah, you see it coming pretty much. And they took off in a blizzard, so they had to have that idea in the back of their head.
Hmm. Yeah, no kidding.
I will debunk one thing, though.
Yeah.
People tend to say, you know, Buddy Holly was a nut for flying in a blizzard, but the bus was such a piece of shit, the tour bus, that one guy, I think, had a frostbite because the heater went. So it was probably more dangerous driving in the bus than it was to fly in a plane.
Oh, no kidding, eh? That's true. Driving around through the winter snow and all that too?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Huh. So just a curious question here. Were you aware of the 27 Club before you got into this?
Didn't Elvis die in a plane crash too? Or did he die in the toilet?
The toilet.
Yeah.
Thinking about a plane.
Who else died in a plane crash? Plane crashes always seem suspicious.
Yeah.
Plane crashes and suicides.
Yeah, and there's all of those.
Yeah. Well, I think lots of people have died in a plane crash, Darren.
I think a lot of people have died on the toilet too.
Yeah.
I think it's got to be something with cocaine and shit.
It does, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Always reminds me of the mobsters, the way they would die.
Yeah. Never, if you're in the mob, you never want to eat at a steakhouse. That's what I know.
Were you interested in the 27 Club before you wrote this?
Actually, you know, I came across it through Gary Patterson's book. And to give the guy props, I think he was the one that sort of discovered it. He was the first person. You know, I feel like I always knew there was a 27 Club, but you know, when he mentioned, I listened to an interview, he mentioned that he was the one who first started writing about it. I don't really find a reference to the 27 Club before his book came out.
How long ago was that?
I think 2005.
Really? I remember talking about that shit in high school.
When was that?
That's what I thought too.
Yeah, like that was I graduated in 2000, I think.
It might be, maybe he wrote the book earlier than that, or wrote an earlier book about it.
But even like early high school, like I wouldn't have read it in a book or anything. It was just something we kind of noticed,
yeah,
right?
Hendrix, too.
We say, yeah, we're going to die when we're 27, and rock stars.
Yeah, but that
we weren't calling it the 27 Club, though.
No, wasn't as many as we thought back then. Like I agree with you that we were thinking about that too, but that was only, I only knew of a handful and I was thinking about it.
Yeah, well, exactly.
Right. When I referred to it, and it might be the idea that it was a bigger club that he came up with.
Yeah.
But, you know, when I look back on it, I was probably thinking of the three big ones, Jim Morrison, Jimi Hendrix, and Janis Joplin. But then you have to add Brian Jones. You have to add Robert Johnson. Some of the people I don't think I even added, because I think Pigpen from the Grateful Dead died at 27.
A buddy that was used to play for Metallica too.
Really?
Cliff Burton, was it?
I don't know.
That sounds right.
I'm pretty sure he did. I'll check. I'll ask my buddy.
Yeah, and then like you said, there was the Cobain and
Amy Winehouse.
Yeah,
and then there are, I feel like I'm leaving some other ones out, but there are, you know, literally dozens of these guys. And a few years ago, there was an attempt to debunk the 27 Club. And it was a researcher, I think he was in England, and he looked at the 27 Club and found that there was no statistical odds. The odds were great that you would die at any time, not just 27 as a rock star. But, you know, so I'm a research writer and I'm used to reading these studies. So I looked at the data and he started his study in 1950, looking at number one songs in England, in the UK. And I forget where he stopped it, but right there, I mean, the rock era really doesn't begin till like 56, I'd say. If you think about the UK, their charts were much different than the US.
Mm-hmm.
And so I don't think the Doors had a number one. They might have had a top 10, but they didn't have a number one.
Not LA Woman.
Janis Joplin. What's that?
LA Woman wasn't number one.
I don't know whether it was in the UK.
Oh, no, probably not. Maybe not in the UK. Must have been here.
In the US, there'd be dozens.
Yeah.
So it seems to me that was kind of cherry picking the data, and I can't prove it, but you know, started in 1956, and then let's see.
What was he doing? Was he looking at all the top songs and then who wrote them, or I mean, who performed them?
Huh. Yeah. And when they died.
Hmm.
And there was no statistical significance of being 27, but I, you know, when you see all the people, it does give you the idea that there's something to that.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, unless 27 is somehow, because of the numerology, sort of
equals nine, which is maybe 3 squared. More, 3 maybe is the key to the universe.
Okay, well, that's exactly. I'm sort of glad you guys said that, because in this book, I want to add to, you know, the conversation. So I tried to find a numerological approach to it. And that's exactly what I came up, that there is something special about the 2 and the 7, or like you guys say, the 9. But you know, that was just a guess.
Yeah. Well, no, I mean,
9's a crazy number.
Yeah.
Which is 3 squared.
Is it a lonely number too, Darren?
No, one is the loneliest number. Don't you remember the song?
I just remembered Lonely Number. I couldn't remember what the lonely number was.
Really?
Yeah.
I guess, all the numbers from 0 to 9 are lonely. Until you get to 10, then you got a buddy.
Yep.
You know what the theme of your book reminded me of is this book that I kind of haven't really forgotten about it over the last, I don't know, maybe 5 or 7 years or whatever. We've talked about it on the show a couple times, but it's called Alien Rock. And it's basically similar to yours in the, and they talk about really, really popular musicians and rock stars and their encounters with, you know, UFOs and aliens and abductions and stuff like that. And again, when you look at it, you're just blown away by the amount of popular artists and you're thinking, well, there has to be some correlation to the level of creativity or the level of popularity that these artists get, because it almost feels like all the popular ones have had some sort of fucking crazy experience.
Yeah. I don't think I heard about that book. I'll have to check that out. Because I, you know, as I researched this, I came across, you know, obviously dozens of stories about UFOs. I have one in the book about, and actually he was such a minor, I think his name was James Sullivan, and he died or mysteriously disappeared not too far away from Roswell. And his last song was about UFOs. So, you know, yada, 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 extrapolation. I, of course, tried to make people think that he was abducted by UFOs. But
or they stuck him up in a weather balloon. And
yeah.
They strung him up in a weather balloon, and he was up floating around in the high atmosphere for a couple of days. Then he came crashing down.
Or maybe it was swamp gas that took him up.
Yeah, maybe.
He was raptured up in swamp gas.
Yeah.
I think I just solved Roswell.
So do you find that there's an overlap between all these, or do you find that these paranormal sort of subjects get stuck in their little box?
No, I think that I really believe it's that rock musicians accept these type of outsider ideas. So you find ghost stories, you find stories about ghosts of rock stars, you find stories about rock stars who believe in ghosts, you have stories about rock stars who believe in UFOs, rock stars who believe in magic, ceremonial magic, Eastern mysticism, all of that, you know, they embrace it all. And I think that's what makes it unique.
Yeah, that's a really good point. I would tend to agree with that. They are that type of character, the artistic type that just really, they don't care what everybody else is doing. They don't care what everybody else thinks. They have that creativity and that it seems like a more of an open mind. I hate to generalize like that, but it does seem like artists seem to have an open mind.
I've come to that conclusion. And, you know, if you give me a second, I can and talk a little bit about Robert Johnson and the Crossroads. And I think it gives you a little insight into the many layers of this spirituality in rock music. So, you know, Robert Johnson, a lot of people know him as this great blues player and, you know, quasi invented rock and roll. You know, he grew up in the Delta. The Delta was not a great place to be a young black man. You had sort of two occupational futures. You could either work in the fields or you could be a blues musician. Blues musicians had the women, and they had the whiskey, and they had the good times. So he wanted to be a blues musician. The only problem was he sucked at playing guitar. So that was a complication. He had a second negative going with him, is that he was super annoying, and he annoyed the shit out of these other great blues players, guys like Son House. And this was back in the 20s, 30s. And he followed them all around the Delta, trying to get licks and tips from them, learn how to play better. And at one point, they just all got sick of him and sort of kicked him out of this circle of musicians. Mm. And at that point in historical record, and we actually do have people, you know, historians have talked to these folks. So this is real history. For about a year, he absolutely disappears and no one really knows where he went. He comes back a year later, almost to the day, they said. And not only can he play the blues, but he plays in his own unique style that's better than anyone. And it doesn't take Son House and the rest of the guys to realize that they believe something supernatural is afoot. And, you know, the legend of going to the Crossroads at midnight, waiting for a man in black to show up. He helps tune your guitar, and then he gives you a contract. You sign it, you get fame and fortune, and he gets your soul. That story was pretty well known. And they started saying, well, you know, Robert Johnson sold his soul to the devil. And Johnson made no bones about it either. He wrote songs basically saying he sold his soul to the devil. He was playing, he would practice in graveyards, and this just added to the legend. And then when he mysteriously died, possibly from poisoning, but no one really knows for sure, you know, that kind of confirmed this theory about, you know, Robert Johnson sold his soul to the devil. Now, when you look at these stories, and when I, you know, researched it, you know, I just wrote that story pretty much. But then when I started to look into it, you know, if you talked to Son House, I never talked to him, but, you know, he's on record as believing the literal Robert Johnson sold his literal soul to the literal devil. He believed that. But if you look at the story itself, what I kind of came away with it is the story of Robert Johnson is the story of every artist, that you try to make it into the mainstream. In Johnson's case, it was this, you know, group of blues musicians, but every artist tries to, you know, do something just as good as his colleagues. But often that artist is kind of kicked out of the circle because they do things a little differently. And so then they come back, and then they have this, you know, their own style. They might have their own type of painting. They might have their own type of guitar playing or what have you. And then the mainstream immediately embraces it. And pretty soon you get everything you desire. You get the wine, the whiskey, and the good times. So, you know, when you look at this ghost story, on one hand, it could be just a neat, creepy ghost story that we like to tell. But on the other level, you see that this story is almost a cautionary tale. And that's what I think makes these stories so interesting. So even if you don't believe in ghosts or anything, and that's fine, but I think you have to respect the lesson, idea that we tell these stories and that these stories are important.
Yeah. Yeah. That's really interesting. Is that what that song that was sort of popular in the '70s or early '80s, that Devil Comes Down to Georgia or whatever? Is that?
That is absolutely correct. That's a different version of it. And that is more of a, you know, the white, European kind of angle to it, where it's a fiddle player, not a guitar player.
Yeah.
Yep, same story. And that story actually goes back to, I think, Africa, and I think there are Greek legends too about gods at the crossroad. And then, of course, if you look at a crossroad, it forms a cross. You know, there's so many layers to this shit.
Yeah, no kidding. So, do you have any other interests, like paranormal type?
Yeah, what's favorite next to ghosts? And do you think you should shoot Bigfoot if you see him?
I don't know. I don't think you should shoot Bigfoot, but I guess I do kind of like the UFO stuff a little bit. You know, the funny thing is, like, I have this side interest in quantum physics and that sort of stuff, the more fringy science stuff. And they're starting to connect, which is the weird thing.
Right.
And I also like, you know, religions and studying Eastern religions and things like that.
So talk about some of the connections with quantum physics now. I mean, that's fascinating, really fascinating stuff.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not an expert. That's the tough thing. But, you know, when you look at ideas of quantum physics, like superposition, that something can be in multiple infinite places basically at the same time, things like entanglement, where there's a seemingly an instantaneous connection between, in some cases, particles essentially across the universe. You know, how weird is it that there would be ghosts? I mean, some of this stuff is just, that's I think what the connection, and of course, when you study Buddhism, it's almost like a lot of the different types of Buddhism, especially the Mahayana Buddhism, you feel like you are reading. It's hard to tell the difference between reading someone who is knowledgeable about Buddhism and someone who's knowledgeable about quantum physics when they talk about emptiness and fullness being the same thing. So when you think about something that is empty, it's not really empty, it's full of potential. And so what is intersecting with that potential? And my guess is it's consciousness.
Yeah, exactly. And the, just the parallels between us all being connected and now really seeing that at a quantum level, we are all connected.
Yeah, I think we're all, essentially it's all one.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's all one.
That's interesting. And we're all just programs in the digital universe.
Did you have any of your own personal synchronicities while you're writing the book?
Yeah, I have. That's a good question. Not that I can recall. I'm sure there was some stuff going on. I don't know whether you know Eilfie music from Paranormal State.
No,
just from reading your bio and stuff like that.
Okay. Yeah, I was working with her one time, and I think she may. So she would be on location, and I was trying to work on her book. And so she would call me from these different hauntings and different investigations she was going on. And I think one time she butt dialed me, and my wife answered the phone and was pretty convinced that we had somehow got Satan involved with our operation here. So that's about as close to a synchronicity as I got.
I won't rate that.
Yeah, don't rate that one, Jared. So what about Omni Reboot? Is that where you're writing about the quantum physics and stuff like that?
Well, it was. And I think that was last year. I was writing for them pretty regularly. And then they sort of went off in a different direction with it. I was trying to return to the... I don't know if you guys remember the original Omni.
Hell yeah. I remember they had the UFO segment month for like 50, was it monthly or yearly? And at the end of that, the magazine disappeared. I was all pissed off and I was like, why, when somebody mainstream finally starts writing about UFOs, and I was following it all the time, I was excited about, you know, that magazine coming out with that, and then boom, gone.
Yeah, and that was the antimatter column.
Oh.
Remember, it was red?
Yeah.
So when they first started this Omni Reboot, my idea was to reboot that antimatter column just like they had it. So there would be a mix of little vignettes of UFO or ghosts or quantum physics or all those. So I started to do that. But then I think they changed editors and they're more focusing on the sci-fi aspect. But I was like you. I used to, you know, I remember going to like the bookstores and looking up and seeing if Omni was there. If Omni wasn't there, I would feel depressed for the next week. You know?
Oh, that's hilarious. Yeah.
Was it like a channel?
It's like a magazine that was kind of like, it was kind of like fringe science, but they talk about stuff like UFOs and all that. It's really cool. It's kind of like a mix between like Popular Mechanics and Pop Sci or even like, yeah, kind of like UFO Open Minds type stuff. It was pretty cool.
There was a fringe sort of science section called Continuum.
Yeah.
And there was a fringe kind of occult supernatural column that was antimatter, Yeah, I loved the whole thing. And then they always had some sci-fi stories.
Yeah. So do you think those are worth anything? I still have a stack of those.
I bet you they are. I know that the folks at Omni Reboot sell a lot of their old stuff. Now it's usually like old paintings. And their artwork was great in that, if you remember some of the graphics and some of the paintings. So it might be worth something. Who knows?
I should at least like take some digital pictures of those, Darren, and put them in a studio or something. Some classic Omni mags.
Looks like they're selling for about the whole 1982.
No. That's way too far back. We're talking like early 90s, probably.
You can get the whole 1982 year for $30 plus $85 shipping. That's where they get you.
That's where they get you.
The 1990 full year, $30 plus $70 shipping. Where the fuck?
That sounds too cheap, man. Where?
Yeah. eBay.
Yeah, that, don't believe that.
Don't believe that. I can buy it right now.
I don't. It's not going to tell you that you have to bid on it or something. That's not the starting bid price. Look, that's disappointing.
Buy it now. Aww. You thought you were sitting on a gold mine with your Omni magazine?
And my MUFON journals.
I'm out of here.
I quit.
And my two Gretzky rookie cards. I still have two Gretzky rookie cards. Cool. I got to try and.
Ooh, Gretzky rookie cards?
Yeah.
Do you really?
Yeah.
Can I have one?
No.
Just for the studio?
You got two.
No, that's not even studio worthy. No hockey in the studio.
Except during the playoffs.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not sure. I don't quote me on this, but I believe the reason that Omni stopped publishing a print version is they went online. And that was probably back in 96, 97.
Just happened to correlate with the end of their UFO segment. That seems too conspiratorial to me.
I don't know. I recall that they went online, and I might be way off on that.
You might be right. I mean, they were definitely, you know, ahead of their time technologically, so they would have been one of the first ones to do that.
Yeah, you never know.
Are they mint?
No, they're not mint.
Oh, are the cards mint?
No, the cards aren't mint. I don't have them in like plastic wrap and all that.
If it's not mint, you're down to under $1,000.
Oh, that's plenty.
Yeah, I think they're probably $300 or $400 a piece.
Sold.
Sold.
I'll sell them to you and you can do all the work and sell them to somebody else.
I think they're mint, it's a couple G's.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't. No.
What about the Omni magazines? Are they mint?
No, they're not mint. They're sitting in a box.
Maybe we could give them out as prizes.
I don't want to do that.
Drum up some sort of something with sign Graham's old Omni magazine collection.
Maybe what we'll do
you might find some of the pages are a little stuck together.
Yeah, very funny. I was just thinking of that other mag that might happen to, but what was the other one with all the girls? Maxim. Yeah. It's right there. Yeah, they're right beside all my Maxim mags.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Don't bring them in the studio. They'll be glowing.
The black light.
Well, so, do you have anything else you want to get to before we wrap this up? Are you on the Twitter and the Facebook and all that fun stuff?
I do have a Facebook site and a Twitter. I think if you just go to Facebook, it's Haunted Rock and Roll, or just I usually come up if you search for that. And I think my Twitter handle is Haunted Rock and R because of Twitter. And I'm not very good at Twitter. So that's basically where I'm at. And the books are, you know, on Amazon or Barnes and Noble or down at your bookstore.
Twitter is a pretty powerful tool, actually.
Oh,
I wish I could work it better, because a lot of these authors, they're really good at it. And I think they sell a lot of books. I'm just, when it comes to the marketing and the self-promotion, I kind of stink at that.
Well, you got in touch with us and that was a step in the right direction.
Yeah, that's because I've always listened to the show, though.
I have an interesting story about that, actually. I go to the movies every once in a while.
And by yourself.
Yeah, so what? Awesome. He had to throw that in there. So I'll kill time in chapters sometimes, and I'll go to the section, you know, like the section of New Age or occult or UFOs or whatever. And anyways, I had just got your email that day, I think, and I went... And I was just looking at your book popped out at me like right away. It was really weird. I was like, oh, that's
wow.
So yeah, I bought it. I bought it the same day you emailed me. I bought your book. That's pretty weird.
After he emailed you?
After he emailed.
Oh.
I forget which episode I was listening to your show. And I was sitting there thinking, well, I wrote a book on ghosts. Maybe they'd be interested in that. And I don't. That's when I decided to reach out. But that's usually I'm listening to all these other authors talk, and I think, well, I wrote a book.
Oh, that's awesome! That's awesome.
I've never, here's the experience I haven't had as an author. I haven't been in just a bookstore in the middle of nowhere and came across my book. That's what I want to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you did though. It was in the Calgary bookstore.
I did. Yeah. Physically came across it. Yeah. That was really cool. But yeah, I'm glad we had the opportunity to talk about ghosts because for some reason it's such a popular subject now too. I mean, all the paranormal investigators and all the ghost shows and all that. And I really like how you put this book together with, you know, rock, which so many people are also interested in. So it gave us an opportunity to hit sort of, you know, ghosts with a better little bit of a twist.
Do you sell the book through your website or anything? Is there any alternatives to Amazon?
I really don't have a sort an author page at all, and that's something I should work on too.
You can get it through Llewellyn. How do you pronounce it? Llewellyn?
Llewellyn.
Llewellyn.
Yeah.
Sounds like a girl's name. Llewellyn.
Yeah.
You know, I just, you know, kind of just to sum it up, I think the one biggest piece of praise I had from this book was I was at a book signing and a lady came up and said to me, she's not a lady, she was sort of a young girl, said, you know, I loved your book. I learned so much about rock and roll. And I think, you know, to go back to my point, these stories, whether you believe them or not, are great ways of transmitting part of the culture and the history of something that I really love, which is rock music and rock history.
That's a great way to say it. Yeah, it's very emotional. Like music hits you at a deep level.
It does.
Yeah. And it really triggers, like, yeah, it sticks with you, right? Like sometimes you just hear that song on the radio and it's like, bam, you're back in fucking, back in the 90s or grounds back in the
or just start early crying.
80s.
Absolutely. It's a time.
Or you start crying. Yeah. Drum solos make you cry.
Yeah.
I'll never live that one down. I shouldn't have talked about that.
No.
Did you cry at a drum solo?
Yeah, I saw Elton John recently in Vegas, and his drummer was just fucking unbelievable. Like, absolutely perfect, and he had, like, three sets of drums going, and there was something about what he was doing was just, like, totally affecting me.
Well, here's my drum solo story. I kind of find them as pretentious.
Okay, right. Yeah. Maybe that's why this one affected me, because it wasn't.
And there was one band, a local band, that the drummer would go into, you know, a 6-minute solo and people just want to drink and dance, right? So everyone cleared off the dance floor to listen to this drummer. And I shot out into the middle and started doing a dance that was kind of part epileptic seizure, part... you know, tribal dance just to ruin his solo. So he was pretty mad at me, but I think, and I'd have to talk to my cousin because I had her picking up the coins that people were throwing at me. I think I made about $2.75.
That's interesting.
That's my drum solo story.
I'm not a normal drum solo fan. Like I like them like everybody else, just normal. Like I would, you know, traditionally I probably would like a guitar solo more than a drum solo, but this one is something about this older gentleman who was playing big, like they were big, you know, there was some bongo type drums, like a whole bunch of different styles of drums. And it was the way he played it to it was perfection really. So I don't know. And I mean, maybe because of the, you know, drums traditionally can kind of alter your state of consciousness as well. So maybe that had something to do with it.
Was it a famous percussionist? Is it someone we would know or?
Probably. It was with Elton John on his last tour ever. So I'm pretty sure he's probably.
Was he like a smaller guy, bald?
I think so. Was he the guy that you danced in front of?
Yeah, I wouldn't doubt it. That's my luck.
So it sounds like you know him.
Yeah. There was one guy, he was big. I think in the 80s, 90s, I remember seeing him, but I don't remember his name.
Is anyone looking it up?
Yeah, I'm trying to look it up here. The Million Dollar Piano. Nigel Olsen, does that ring a bell?
It doesn't ring a bell. I don't know whether that's the same guy. this guy was really, I mean, he was in actually in a lot of videos, late '80s, early '90s. Hmm. And I felt like he was in a couple Elton John videos.
Hmm. Yeah. I'd have to read, it looks like there's a big, the big write up here and a lot. I'd have to go through it, but it really made me realize, cause I mean, music's always had a pretty deep effect on me, but this really made me realize how important art is too, and how deep some of that can hit you. Like it was pretty much uncontrollable. Like I couldn't just say, oh, I'm not going to feel this emotion. It was like instant.
That's a spiritual experience.
Yeah, totally.
Is it that dude?
No, it doesn't look like that dude.
That's Nigel Olsen.
No, I'm pretty sure he was older and he might have been bald. He might have had a hat on.
A five head. Guy. Didn't have a faux head. He had a five head.
So yeah, I guess it was a spiritual experience.
Yeah, I mean, that's all the kind of the symptoms of it. Deep emotions. You can't hold the emotions.
Yeah, yeah.
Glad that came up again, eh?
Yeah, thanks, buddy.
Well, I suppose that's a good note to wrap it up on.
There you go.
Yeah, thanks a lot for coming aboard, Matt. It's been a slice. Our listeners will finally get their ghost episode. 120.
Well,
took 120 episodes, but here we are.
Hey, and another 120, have me back.
Right on.
I like country, so.
Yeah, we'll have to do the country one. I know you guys are going to love it.
Well, maybe by then, if we do another 120 episodes, maybe he'll come out with a rock and roll sequel. We can just...
You know, they call Calgary right Cowtown, right?
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
Is there a big country scene in there?
Oh, God.
Oh, yeah. It's the Wild West here. The Calgary Stampede's like the biggest rodeo on earth.
No, is it?
Yeah. They call it the greatest outdoor show on earth. It's definitely one of the biggest, if not the biggest.
Is Katie Lang from...
Or most prize money or something, maybe. It's something, anyway.
Is Katie Lang from Calgary?
I don't know.
She might be from Canada, but I don't know.
Okay.
It's a weird phenomenon. When I first moved here from Vancouver, I realized how, like, as soon as the Stampede starts, like, the Thursday before, all of a sudden...
Gone country.
Everybody's at short shorts and boots and cowboy hats, and, yeah, it's, like, instant.
Hmm.
So it's fun for about a week.
Yeah. How long does it last?
10 days, I think.
Oh.
Yeah.
Wow. A little disruptive.
Yeah, it's very
disruptive. Oh, yeah. It's like there's like 100 to 150,000 people a day through the gate.
Wow.
It's like fucking expensive, too. You can't go for a shit in there without spending fucking 50 bucks.
All right, well, maybe that's the note we should leave it.
Yeah, that's the one.
Please. Yeah, we'll check out the book for sure. We encourage our listeners to check out the book. And, yeah, we can't wait for the next one.
Thanks a lot, guys. I had a lot of fun.
Great. Glad you did. So did we. Thanks, Matt. Take care.
Thank you. Right. See you guys.
And we're back in the Grimerica show. We are. That was our chat with Matt Swayne. I think we're back after a music break that you would have just put in there, right? Please tell me. Are you going to do that still?
Oh, I'm going to cut back to you silence for a few minutes. I'll edit it to perfection.
So thanks, Matt, for coming on. That was a great, I don't know, it was one of my favorite chats. I like chatting about old Omni magazines and, yeah, it's good to chat with an open-minded person who's doing the research into this type of stuff. And it kind of trips me out that pop culture musicians have had a lot of ghostly and alien experiences. It seems to be abnormally something to do with creative artistic types that are more open to it. Or maybe that's why they're creative and artistic, because those experiences have happened.
No.
What comes first?
The chicken.
Oh, really?
But it's not quite a chicken. It's closer to something else. And it has an egg. That becomes the first chicken. That didn't work out.
Yeah, I didn't really get you there. But no, really, what do you think?
About?
What comes first, the experience or the creativity?
The creativity. The experience and the creativity, I don't think have anything to do with each other.
Don't you think that a lot of these famous pop culture types
maybe it's have because experiences? They've done more drugs, so they've thinned the skin, thinned really? The veil.
No, that can stop you from having experiences. Maybe it's
being popular.
Does it?
I don't know.
You just won't correlate what I'm asking you
I've
to
never
correlate.
Been popular. I just don't think there's any connection between having experience and creativity. Mm. Because otherwise you'd be saying that all creative people would have to have had some sort of experience, or for most of them at least, right? It wouldn't just be one. And
that's what I'm getting at, though, is I think that if you looked at it, if you were to do like a massive, what do you call that when you ask a bunch of people questions?
Survey?
That you would find that artistically creative people, and especially maybe popular ones, have had more experiences, unexplained experiences, whether it be ghosts or UFOs or aliens or occult experiences, than normal people, so-called normal people. That's what I'm saying. I think you would see that.
I think you're wrong. And I'm not saying that just to be confrontational.
Hmm.
I don't know. I've never really considered it, and I'm not buying it.
Mm.
I'm skeptical of everything, as the jingle says.
So after we finished up this interview, I was emailing Matt back and forth because I was looking up that drummer, right? You know how we talked about that,
oh,
that drummer?
Oh, did we get into that? Yeah, we did too. Yeah,
yeah, okay. We did too. And his name is Ray Cooper. So I emailed him. I said, hey, Matt, the guy, the drummer I was talking about, yeah, you were right. He's like kind of a short, bald head, older fellow. I go, his name is Ray Cooper. And he says, yeah, that's the guy. I remember reading about him and thinking, how can a guy be that good on maracas or bongos that people keep asking him to record with them? I guess he's that good. Anyway, thanks for a fun chat yesterday. Happy to do it again.
Hmm.
So yeah, he's that good.
He's that good.
Yeah.
For you, anyway. Were you? Was that an isolated incident, or was it like a bunch of people? Did you look around?
No, I didn't look around.
Hmm.
We should. I'm sure it's happened to people before. What's that?
We should do some drum things. I was just thinking, I swear I seen something about Elton Don, you and Elton John. Elton Graham. I swear it was in the last Lost Bread.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's pretty funny.
I'm almost positive.
Lost Bread is a comic blog from Napoleon on our website, grimerica.ca. It's pretty funny, and he throws these little Easter eggs in there.
He just released the key, I think, the answer to all the Easter eggs in the first two issues.
Oh, did he?
Yeah. So check that out. It's under Lost Bread. I should make that easier to link. I'll make a link maybe. That's just like grimerica.ca/bread or something. That actually might be set up already. If not, it's like grimerica.ca/category/lostbread.
Yeah.
But yeah, check it out. Thanks for listening. As always, support the show, grimerica.ca/support. Help us keep the lights on. Sign up for the newsletter, grimerica.ca/news. Review the show and spam Graham. I'd like to put the call out for
Extra
Graham spam over the next little while.
That's G-R-A-H-A-M, not Graham, at grimerica.com.
It's Graham at grimerica.com. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next week. Well, I'm on vacation. Thank you.
I'm a rambling gram with synchronicities all over the web. And Aaron is skeptical about everyone and don't believe it yet.
I just moved in my new house today.